Hi, I'm Erika. I've worked with a lot of test takers over the years, and many of them want what I have, a 100th percentile GMAT 735 score. Over the last decade, I've helped thousands of students achieve their GMAT score goals, and along the way, I've become very familiar with the kinds of mistakes that keep test takers from getting a high GMAT score. In this video, I'm going to share 7 of the most common GMAT mistakes that you need to avoid if you want to get a 735 on the GMAT, like me. The first mistake that keeps students from achieving a high GMAT score is practicing only hard questions. I see this one a lot, especially from test takers with high score goals, and it makes sense on its face. Study for the score you want, right? But this betrays a serious misunderstanding of the test's algorithm. Your GMAT score on test day is less about the hardest question you get right and more about the easiest question you get wrong. In fact, if you're missing easy to medium difficulty questions on test day, you probably won't even see the hard questions you've been practicing. The right call is to instead practice at your current difficulty level. This is the difficulty at which you're currently getting about half of the questions wrong. And this is the difficulty that the GMAT algorithm would target if you took your test today. Now, this will likely be below your desired difficulty level, and that's okay. That's what study is for. The goal is to improve so much with your study that you start getting less than half of the questions wrong, indicating an increase in your difficulty level. At that point, you can increase the difficulty of your practice questions to match. Then it's just a matter of repeating the process until you reach your desired difficulty level, both in your practice and on test day. Mistake number 2 is ignoring less common subjects. Now, I know what you're thinking. Oh, you have to study everything. Groundbreaking strategy. But hear me out. Ignoring certain topics can actually be a pretty good strategy on other non-question level adaptive tests. Deciding in advance that you'll likely get the one question of a certain hyper-specific subject wrong means that you can free up study time and mental bandwidth for subjects that make up a greater proportion of questions on the test, thus resulting in more correct questions overall. It's actually pretty smart, but it unfortunately doesn't work as well on the GMAT. Because of the GMAT algorithm, getting that one hyper-specific question wrong means that the test is going to follow up at some point later with another question similar to that hyper-specific question. And then if you get that one wrong, your difficulty level goes down, which in turn brings your score down. On other tests, getting one question wrong is getting one question wrong. On the GMAT, getting a question wrong opens up the possibility of significant downstream effects. The fix here is pretty straightforward. Ensure your study is balanced overall, with a bias toward the subjects you're most frequently getting questions wrong in. Mistake number 3 is running out of time on a section. Now, this is a test day mistake, and you'd be surprised how common this one is. Earlier this year, GMAC revealed that less than half of test takers finish each section with more than 2 minutes to review, with some sections worse than others. Only 25% of test takers finish data insights with time to spare. The remaining 50 to 75% of test takers fit one of the following profiles: finishing the section right on time, but not getting to take advantage of the review and edit feature, rushing through the last few questions to beat the buzzer, and straight up not getting to answer some number of questions. All of these cases hurt your score. Not editing questions means losing an opportunity to avoid getting them wrong. Rushing through questions increases your chances of getting them wrong, and not answering questions guarantees getting them wrong. And getting multiple questions wrong at the end of a section is particularly bad because it tanks your difficulty level and thus your score with no opportunity to recover it. Solution? Dial in your time management strategy. Top scorers know when to bookmark a question for review and edit, make a guess, and move on to give themselves a chance on questions they may be more likely to answer correctly. The 4th mistake is rushing into solving. Now, I know it's really annoying to tell you not to run out of time and then immediately tell you to slow down, but it's unfortunately true that moving too quickly at the beginning of a question is one of the main things that cost test takers points. There are a lot of different ways this can happen. Misunderstanding what the question is asking for, not figuring out how key pieces of information fit together, totally missing key pieces of information altogether, inadequately setting up your scratch paper for solving, etc., etc. But the fix for all of these potential errors is the same: investing a little extra time up top to process the question. Not only does this increase your chances of getting the question right, it also often saves time by preventing you from going down an incorrect or unnecessarily slow path. Let me know if you want a video series on setting yourself up for success on different types of GMAT questions. These are legitimately some of my most powerful strategies. Mistake number 5 is falling into last second traps. Now, if the last mistake was rushing into solving, this one is rushing into answering. In fact, I often tell my students that most questions are missed in the first 30 seconds or the last five. Even if you've done an incredible job of setting yourself up for success before solving, it's really easy to get so excited to answer the question that you miss something right at the end. So solving for X instead of Y, forgetting about an edge case, not noticing the one word in an answer choice that makes it too extreme, and so on. These are incredibly frustrating mistakes because they largely catch test takers who almost got the question right. There's a pretty simple fix here. Pause before picking an answer. Ask yourself, am I solving for the right thing? Have I missed something? And my favorite, what's the trap? You'll be amazed at how many questions this can save for you in almost no time at all. Mistake number six is going into test day a burnt out mess. I hate to see this one. It's one of the most frequent causes of repeat test taking among my students. But convincing them to avoid it is a tough sell. Test takers want to be as prepared as possible for their test day. So the more practice they cram into the days and hours leading up to their exam, the better, right? Not so. Not only is last-minute practice unlikely to teach you anything, it is likely to both wear and stress you out, leading to worse performance on the actual test. So how do we avoid it? By prioritizing our mental and physical health in the run-up to test day. I recommend taking your last practice test a full week out from your test day. This should give you plenty of time to error log and do a reasonable amount of targeted practice while still reserving the last day or two before your exam for rest and review. Which leads us to our final mistake, mistake number seven, skipping review in your study. We talked about the value of review and edit on test day. Now let's talk about the value of review as a follow-up to your practice. I see so many test takers do a bunch of practice problems, pat themselves on the back, and call it a day. But they've actually missed the most important part of their study session. Review is where the magic actually happens. It's where we figure out what mistakes we made, why we made them, and how we can recognize and avoid them in the future. Without review, we're likely to make the same mistakes over and over and over again, which builds bad habits as we're effectively practicing making the mistakes. The solution to skipping review is doing the opposite, investing time in it. I recommend setting aside as much time for reviewing problems as you do for practicing them. I even recommend spending a little time at the beginning of each study session reviewing your previous day's work. This prompts you to shape your study session around what you're currently struggling with most, as well as ensures that your mistakes are top of mind, so you're less likely to repeat them. I hinted at this earlier, but an error log is an incredibly powerful tool for this. Check out the Target Test Prep channel for more info on how to make and keep a good one. More than any of the mistakes in this video, the worst GMAT mistake you can make is one you've made before. Review helps you with that. And those are seven mistakes you cannot make if you want a 735 GMAT score. Now, of course, do you really need a 100th percentile GMAT score to get into the business school of your dreams? Probably not. But regardless of your score goal, avoiding these mistakes will help you get all the points you can and perform your best on testing. Let me know if this video helped you by liking and subscribe for more videos from me and the other experts here at Target Test Prep. And if you have questions or comments or suggestions for future videos, leave them in the comments below. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you back here real soon.